by the way, in the COVID pandemic is the third worst pandemic in the last 650 years measured by fatalities. So even if you want to distinguish between vaccinated and unvaccinated, and I think there's a lot of problems with that, in the unvaccinated group, what about the 33 million recovered individuals who had COVID and have the antibodies? Shouldn't they at least be put in a different category? You're not hearing that at all in the United States. It's not discussed. It's as if they don't exist. It's as if there's a crusade for 100% vaccination, and children shouldn't get the children should not get the vaccine. The side effects are, it's not even close. The side effects in children are far worse than the disease, which they rarely get, don't spread. And this has all happened in about a year and a half. You know, usually some of these drug trials only go on for 2, 3, 5 years or longer. We don't know what the side effects of these are going to be, although some of them are starting to appear now that the vaccines have been around for 6 months or even longer. Again, we referred earlier to the fact that they call the new infections of the vaccinated. So the vaccinated are getting sick, and they call it a breakthrough infection. Well, just call it an infection. You know, spare me your euphemisms. You got the vaccine, you got infected, you're sick. That's happening. Don't blame the unvaccinated. By the way, in the COVID pandemic is the third worst pandemic in the last 650 years measured by fatalities. Number one was the Spanish flu, 1918-1919. Number two was the Black Death of the 1350s, in the mid-14th century. And number three is COVID. COVID is up to about 4 million deaths worldwide. The next closest pandemic, the number of fatalities was about 200,000. That was the Asian flu in 1958. So yeah, it's serious. I mean, a lot of deaths and a lot of cases. But we have to remember, you know, everyone's shouting, you know, the cases are up. They are. The fatalities are not up. Fatalities have kind of plateaued for the reasons we mentioned, better treatment and better clinical experience, et cetera. So let's not equate a case of COVID with a death. And politicians are doing that. They say, if you don't get this vaccine, you're going to die. Well, actually, you're not going to die. You might get COVID, and people with the vaccine might get COVID. We're now learning that. But if you do, you have, depending on your age group, comorbidities, and other factors, you have a 99.8 or 0.2, again, depending on your age, chance of survival. And younger people without asthma or diabetes or obesity or other, when I say younger, you know, even people in their 30s, 40s, and 50s, have a very, very low mortality rate from this. So I think there'll be divisions between countries that are pursuing different policies. And you mentioned a few of the extreme cases. Iceland, I put New Zealand in the same category. Maybe Australia, based on what we're seeing, versus other countries that, such as the UK, that have had a tough time of it, but it seemed to take a live and let live attitude. So there'll be divisions among the countries, and then within the countries, there'll be divisions between the unvaccinated and the vaccinated. Now, there's a very large group that no one talks about that I think is critically important. There is a group, a large group in the United States. It's 33 million people, or 10% of the population, who had COVID and recovered. Well, they have better antibodies than people with the vaccines. They have the natural antibodies that one would expect. And those seem to be much more long lasting than the vaccine produced responses, molecular responses. So what about them? They're technically unvaccinated. That's true. But they have better antibodies than those who have the vaccination. You know, usually some of these drug trials only go on for 2, 3, 5 years or longer. We don't know what the side effects of these are going to be, although some of them are starting to appear now that the vaccines have been around for 6 months or even longer. Again, we referred earlier to the fact that they call the new infections of the vaccinated. So the vaccinated are getting sick, and they call it a breakthrough infection. Well, just call it an infection. You know, spare me your euphemisms. You got the vaccine, you got infected, you're sick. That's happening. Don't blame the unvaccinated. But even if you want to distinguish between vaccinated and unvaccinated, and I think there's a lot of problems with that. In the unvaccinated group, what about the 33 million recovered individuals who had COVID and have the antibodies? Shouldn't they at least be put in a different category? You're not hearing that at all in the United States. It's not discussed. It's as if they don't exist. It's as if there's a crusade for 100% vaccination, and children should not get the vaccine. The side effects are, it's not even close. The side effects in children are far worse than the disease, which they rarely get, don't spread. And this has all happened in about a year and a half. We're seeing a boom in housing prices in Australia, no doubt about it. We're seeing the same thing in the United States and Canada and some other countries. So it's a bit of a global phenomenon. I think this is one that's different than past bubbles, and I would just kind of reserve judgment on the bubble aspect of it in the following sense. You know, the old cliche in real estate is, you know, location, 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 you gotta get the right location. And that's true, that's always been true. But what we're seeing is a kind of exodus from urban centers moving out into either suburban areas or what are sometimes called ex-urban areas, that's the next ring past the suburbs, or even out into the country. I'm up here in New England in the United States. We've seen people in New York buying, you know, very attractive homes in places like New Hampshire and Vermont, sight unseen. I mean, they'll go to the website and take the virtual tour, call a broker, put in a bid, and then kind of get up and drive up and look at the house they just bought. So, you know, every death is one too many, and there's enough tragedy to go around. But just because the caseload is going up, it doesn't mean the fatalities are going up. They're not. But one thing that is going up is immunity. If you have it and you don't die, and that's 99%+ of the people, you're in pretty good shape. And so that's when that factor gets big enough, it's called herd immunity. It does seem that the UK is sort of moving towards something like herd immunity. Again, I'm not anti-vax. If you want to get the vaccination, you know, be my guest. I would just sound all these cautionary notes about what it really is, how it really works, and whether it lasts. But if you want it, that's fine. It's readily available. But the greatest source of resistance to the disease will be survivors. There's the main model used in epidemiology to forecast and track the course of a pandemic is called the SEIR model. It's a susceptible, exposed, infected, and recovered. So let's not forget about the R. And some people do die. I mean, I'm not making light of that, but basically getting it and surviving it, which is the most likely result, is how a society gets past a pandemic. The COVID pandemic is the third worst pandemic in the last 650 years measured by fatalities. I think this is one that's different than past bubbles, and I would just kind of reserve judgment on the bubble aspect of it in the following sense.